It's hard to imagine that the powerful Generative Remove brush was added to Lightroom in May, just 5 months ago. And as far as I'm concerned, the Gen Remove brush is one of Lightroom's most powerful tools, and it single-handedly resurrected photos that I never thought I'd have a chance to edit because it got rid of distractions that were either unfeasible or would just take way too much time to make it worth it. Now, since Gen Remove was added, the tool's gotten some improvements, but my purpose for this video is to focus on helping you maximize your chances of getting high-quality results when using it. To start, it's important to remember that Generative Remove is powered by Adobe Firefly, so the results that you get from one image to the next, or even from one stroke to the next, can vary. Still, there are five best practice tips that you should keep in mind because doing so will increase the likelihood of getting great results. Also, these tips apply to each of Lightroom's surfaces that support Gen Remove. So whether you're using Lightroom Desktop, Classic, Mobile, or Web, these tips will be useful to remember. So let's dive in. All right, so here we are in Lightroom Desktop on my Mac. But remember, as long as your version of Lightroom, pretty much wherever it is, supports Gen Remove, these tips will apply. And so the first tip, by far, is the most important. I didn't want to kind of leave it to the end. I want to start off with it because if you're going to walk away with anything, this is it. And the reason why I'm including it in the number one spot is because I think this is what causes the most amount of negative feedback and negative results when it comes to using Gen Remove. And that has to do with using Gen Remove first, the very first thing you do before any sort of editing. So when you look at a photo, this is obviously an edited stock photo that I found, but there's always what we call an order of operations. So what do you do first? What do you do next? Now, when it comes to Gen Remove, the key is to do that first, especially before you crop. So let's just say, you know, I crop. So I want to crop first. That's just what I'm used to. So I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to tighten this up a little bit just so that it, you know, for whatever reason, this is the crop that I want for whatever reason. All right. And I'm like, oh, you know what? I don't want this sign up here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the remove tool here. I'm going to make sure that Gen Remove is enabled. You can see this checkbox right here. Make sure that's enabled. And then I'm going to go ahead with a nice big brush and I'm going to make my selection of the sign. So pretty much like that. Then let's go ahead and click on remove. And you can see here that there's still a sign. And if I go through these variations, there are still signs. The reason why it's so critical for you to do your Gen Remove strokes before anything else is because when Lightroom looks at this, even though I cropped in, Lightroom still sees all of those pixels because we're working in a non-destructive workflow. So all those pixels, even though we cropped in, are still there. They will be there until you export that file into another image and then it'll get baked in. But for this purpose though, all that information is there. So when you make that selection, Lightroom's still seeing part of the sign. And so it's like, oh, maybe you just want a different sign. It's not going to remove it, as you can see again. So what do we have to do? Well, let's delete that stroke here. Let's go back to crop. Let's reset the crop. So now we are back at our original image. Now what I can do is I can go to the remove tool with Gen Remove, and I'm going to make my selection of the entire sign. Let's go ahead and click on remove. And there you go. Now that sign is completely gone and we are free to crop to our heart's content. So something like this, and there we go. Now, one point I want to make though is, let's say I wanted to remove this here, this sign. Well, this sign is still fully in the shot, even though I cropped in. Where it really counts is when you want to remove something that's kind of hitting the edge of your frame, and you've cropped in, that's why it's so important. Like I could remove this sign and that won't be a problem unless I decide to, you know, like crop in like this and then I want to remove it. Well, that little bit of the sign that was there, if I undo, Lightroom will see that. And so Generative Remove will try to fill it in because it still sees part of it. So that's why it's so important that you first do your Generative Remove, get rid of the stuff that you want to get rid of, and then start cropping in. All right, so for best practice tip number two, this also, it doesn't have to do with crop, but it has to do with what you select when you want to remove something. In some cases, it should seem obvious, but if you don't do it correctly, the results may not be as good. And so for this one, what I want to do is remind you that if you want to remove a person, for example, or an object, and that object is casting a shadow, do not just get rid of the person, but get rid of the shadow as well. So let's illustrate this. Again, a stock photo that I found. I'm going to make a big brush here. And I'm just going to start with what I think most people do is they just say, I want to get rid of this person here. Let's go ahead and click on remove. And we have another person. Now, the thing is, you really can't blame Lightroom or Generative Remove because it's kind of doing what it should be doing. It's intelligent enough to see that, oh, well, there's a shadow here, and I know that the user removed this part, so they must want a different person because I see the shadow, and so I'm going to fill it in. And you can see with these variations, some of the things it fills it in with can be, you know, interesting or funny. And I mean, it kind of makes sense, but this is not what we want. And the reason why Gen Remove is kind of doing this, why the Firefly model is giving us this, is because, I'm sorry, it's actually working intelligently based on the parameters. Let's go ahead, let's delete this, and let's start over, except this time I'm going to make the same stroke, except I'm also going to go out into the shadow area, making sure that I get the shadow she casts, and then let's go ahead and click on remove. And then there you go. I mean, perfect. I don't even have to look at the other variations, because when you are working the way Gen Remove is intended to work, when you're working within those parameters, you'll get good results more often than not. So first one is make sure you apply Gen Remove first in your order of operations. And then the second is to make sure that you include a shadow of the person or the object if it's being cast, especially if it's quite visible. All right, so for the third tip, it follows the same logic as shadows, except it has to do with reflections. So again, talking to the intelligence of Gen Remove, let's say I want to get rid of the tree and the reflection. You know, here, if I go ahead and I just select the tree and I click on remove, and you can see that Lightroom is intelligent. I mean, I'm sorry, it's doing what it should do intelligently. So the key is, in addition to shadows, if your subject or if the person is casting a reflection somewhere, like even on, you know, a wet sandy beach, make sure that you get both and then click on remove, and you will get good results. I mean, again, it's not 100% because it's still an AI model, but in my experience, and I've used Gen Remove a lot, when you do things the way that it's kind of intended, when you use the tool the way it's intended, the results are more often than not really, really good. So that was tip number three. All right, so for this image, this is one of my own images, I'm going to be able to illustrate tips four and five. So tip four is an opportunity for me to illustrate one of the improvements that came into Lightroom with the October 2024 Adobe Max update. And that has to do with making multiple strokes kind of in one session. So in previous versions of Lightroom, let's say I wanted to go ahead and remove this bike behind this cart. And then let's say I also wanted to remove this over here, or maybe this window up here. I would get an error saying that the selection has to be connected. Lightroom didn't allow for multiple selections or multiple disconnected selections. So now though, tip number four is, you know, work smart. You can now make multiple selections here. So I'm going to make a selection here. I'll get rid of that. And then also the window up here. You can see we have four different selections. I'm going to go ahead and click on remove. And you can see that Lightroom did a bang up job of getting rid of all of those selections. In fact, if you looked away and looked back, I would defy you to even remember what I actually removed. All right, so for my fifth and final tip, that's a reminder that you don't always have to use Gen Remove. It's okay to turn it off. And the reason for that is it really depends on what you need to remove. Of course, if you need to remove a person or a complex object, then of course Gen Remove is the ideal tool. But let's say you're getting rid of dust spots or just little things throughout the image. If you turn off Gen Remove, then you're still going to use the Content Aware Remove brush, which we've had forever since before Gen Remove was put in, and it's a very powerful tool. So here, as a reminder, if you turn off use generative AI, but you're still in the remove brush here, what you can do is just adjust your brush here and get rid of just little things where you don't need to use any sort of cloud computing. As you can see, it's like really fast, does a great job. And again, if I had dust spots, I would use that. Of course, I can kind of get rid of these areas here or even this section right behind the guy. The point is that the content aware remove brush, again, which is activated by turning off generative AI, is it's really good. I mean, it does a great job and it's very, very fast because it doesn't actually have to do any cloud compute like I mentioned. All right, so to recap my five tips to get optimal gen remove results, tip number one, again, put that at the beginning of your order of operations. Use gen remove before you do anything, especially cropping. Tip number two, make sure that when you do remove a subject, if it is casting a shadow, include the shadow in your stroke. Same thing, tip number three has to do with reflections. If the subject has a reflection in some sort of body of water or something that is showing a reflection, include that in the stroke. And then tips number four and five. Tip number four is you can use multiple strokes in one session, so you don't have to do one at a time. Just select everything that you want to remove. And then finally, tip number five is remember that you don't always have to use generative remove. The content aware remove brush is ideal for smaller things and dust spots and those kinds of distractions. Now, gen remove is just one small part of Lightroom. Lightroom is actually super powerful. And if you want to learn absolutely everything there is to know about Lightroom desktop, mobile, and web, then please do check out my course called Lightroom Everywhere. It's got almost 11 hours of easy paced lessons, and it has been updated to include all of the new features and improvements that were announced at Adobe Max in October 2024. I'll leave a link to it in the description below. If you're interested in learning even more about gen remove, here's my video about the feature when it was first announced in May. Of course, if you found this video helpful, a thumbs up really does help. And please be sure to click on subscribe and the bell icon to get notified of all future videos. Thanks a lot, everyone.